Good morning. Glad to see everybody this morning. Robin Williams, wasn't that movie? Good morning, Vietnam. Well, we're not in Vietnam, but good morning, Garrett County. So, anyway, we're thrilled to have you here this morning. Let's start things off with Jesus Messiah. Here we go.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. And the whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. It was love so amazing.
Here we go, church.
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God with us, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Jesus Messiah, he's Lord of all, the Lord of all, the Lord of all.
Amen. You may be seated.
Psalm 22, starting in verse 23, says, "You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. All you descendants of Israel, revere him. For he has not despised or abhorred the torment of the oppressed. He did not hide his face from him, but listened when he cried to him for help. Isn't it good that our God listens to us when we cry for help? Amen. I will give praise in the great assembly because of you. I will fulfill my vows before those who fear you. The humble will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord God, our mighty God, the one who is so worthy of our praise, of our proclamation, of our honor, of our revering. Lord, you are mighty. You are beautiful. You are Messiah, Lord of all. And so this morning, Lord God, I thank you for the blessing we have to be gathered together, both in person and during this service. We're online, we're on the radio. We've got these options, Lord. And we're thankful for the blessing that we have to do it. Let us not take it for granted. This morning, our hearts are so prone to wander. We're so prone to distraction, to selfishness. Even the busyness of the coming week and the notifications on our phone, Lord, they're tugging at us right now. But I pray today, may we only see you. May we only focus on you. May we only listen to you. Lord, help us seek you this morning. It's in your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, good morning, 11 o'clock. Good to see all y'all here with us in person today, as well as those tuning in on Facebook. Hi, Mom. How are you? Good to see you. It's a camera, but I'm going to say I'm seeing you. Good to see y'all on Facebook, as well as on the radio. For those who don't know, aren't acquainted with my goofy self, my name is Brian. I'm pastor here at Heightsville Baptist Church, and we are glad you're with us. Heightsville, we're a church. You know, we believe it is an honor to serve God and his church. Amen? It's not an obligation. It's an honor, because when we serve joyfully and sacrificially, we're just following in the footsteps of our Jesus, who served way more joyfully and sacrificially than we ever could even start to do. And so if you're new to these parts, if this is one of your first time visiting, we're particularly glad you're here. We got a couple different ways you can connect with us. One is on our connection card right here on the bulletin. Just tear that off, fill it out, and drop it in the offering boxes at the back of the worship center. Or you can go to HeightsvilleBaptistChurch.com, clickety-clack over there to that Connect tab, fill out the form. We'll get that this week and contact you. Or if you're watching on Facebook, be sure to hit up our comments, slide into our DMs. Our virtual greeter, the always beautiful Brittany Watts, is up in the comments right now. She'll be happy to talk with you and help you connect to HBC through church online. We're just delighted to worship. I've just been wound up. I'm not usually excited on a rainy day. Those tend to get me a little in the dreary. But you know what? After the cold we've had the last couple of weeks, I'm just happy the temperature's up a little bit. I'll take the rain if it's not icing. So with all that, Dan, will you come up and lead us in our fellowship hymn?
You remember back in the 70s and 80s, you know, when an NFL guy or a college football player would score a touchdown and the camera zoomed in on his face, what did he used to say? Hi, Mom. Remember that, you know? And the dad would always get mad because they felt slighted, because the first thing they say is, hi, Mom, you know? So the first thing preacher does and the first thing is, hi, Mom.
Hey, Dad.
There you go. Well, my mom and dad are watching from Texas right now, so I'm going to say hi to them too. So there, hi. But we're thrilled you guys are here this morning. We're going to have a good day in the house of the Lord. Fanny J. Crosby is known as the hymn queen. There's a lot of really cool history and a lot of cool stories behind the hymns that are in this hymnal. And Fanny J. Crosby is one of those. She began writing hymns when she was about 40 years old. She lived to be about 94. But she wrote over 9,000 hymns. We have 17 of her hymns just in our Baptist hymnal alone. And the amazing thing about Fanny is that she was blind from the time she was 6 weeks old. So she wrote all of these as a blind person. And back in 1882,
Now, Billy, you probably remember this. You know, 1882, Fanny had attended a revival meeting, one of those old-fashioned tent revival meetings, you know. And that night for the invitation, the church sang "At the Cross." And on that last verse, they sang, "Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do." And at that moment, Fanny felt the Holy Spirit tug at her heart, and she leapt to her feet, and she said, "Hallelujah! Hallelujah!" She said, "For the first time, I realized that I had tried to hold the world in one hand and my Lord in the other." And she said, that's when she became redeemed and a Christian. And it's that she went home and penned this song that we're about to sing, "Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It." Let's welcome each other as we sing. Here we go.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
Let's continue our worship this morning. You know this one. This is the Israel Housen version of "I Surrender All." Sing with me.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence day. Jesus, I surrender humbly at His feet. I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus. Take me now. Let me feel Thy Jesus, I surrender all to Him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live.
Here we go, church.
I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. I surrender all.
Get an amen in the house.
Amen. You may be seated.
A couple of things just to keep y'all in the know as we're continuing in worship this morning. First of all, I want to remind you about prayer meeting tonight. 6 o'clock, we'll be right up in here in the same room unless the Lord comes back before now and then. You know, on Sunday mornings, our focus is more on the preaching of the word, and then we pray in addition to that. On Sunday nights, we flip that a little bit. We focus, while we have a time in the word, more on prayer. We believe truly that the Lord answers prayers, and so on Sunday nights, we spend time in praise, in thanksgiving, in lifting our requests, both local and global, to our God in expectation that He will answer them. I hope that you'll be here tonight at 6 o'clock for that. Additionally, a little bit of exciting news. Next Sunday morning, we are bringing back our community groups, our small group ministry here at Hyattsville Baptist Church. I'm telling you this for two things. First of all, so that way you can be getting excited. If you've never been plugged into a community group, hold on to that thought. I'll get to you in a minute. But it is just a blessing to be able to be in that community time together, sharing our lives and studying the word with one another. And so I hope that you'll be a part of that. If you've never been in one before, the opportunity is coming for you to join us in our HBC 101. What is that, you might ask? Well, here at Hyattsville Baptist Church, we want you to feel welcome and a part of the family as quickly as possible. And part of that is through a new community group that we're starting. It'll happen a couple times through the year for a four-week span each round, talking through the very basics of what it means to be a member at Hyattsville Baptist Church. And so this is going to be a group. It'll start next Sunday and run for the four Sundays of March, where we'll come together in a smaller group setting and study the word in addition to what that applies to specifically here at Hyattsville Baptist Church. And so if you're a visitor, if you're a new member, if you're just curious, or honestly, I'd recommend every member join it at some point in the future. You know, it'd be weird if we have like a bunch of new people around here that have gone through HBC 101, but all the long-timers don't have a clue what's going on in there. That'd be a little odd. So sign-ups for that are both in our Church Center app or a physical sign-up sheet is right out here on the bulletin board. Be sure to hit that up if you're interested. I would encourage you, jump on this opportunity. If you've never been in a community group before, if you don't know what that's about, this is a great way to test the waters. You know, do it for 4 weeks and see how it feels to be able to spend time together in a small group setting of believers. I strongly encourage you to hit that up. Additionally, we've got a couple missions things going on here at Hyattsville right now. First of all, I want to remind you about the Gospel to Every Home Evangelism Initiative. We kicked that off last Sunday with our prayer journey. We're spending 40 days in prayer right now, praying over the 1,100 homes that we will be personally taking the gospel to as Hyattsville Baptist Church in the month of March, which, for the record, starts tomorrow. Tomorrow is March. That both feels like 6 years since the last time we said the word March, and also yesterday. If y'all know what I'm saying, it's been a wild ride, hasn't it? So we are back in March tomorrow, and in that month, we're going to be taking the gospel to every home in Garrett County, starting that off here at HBC. And so we want to bait that whole process in prayer. That's why we're doing this 40-day journey. That's why I implore you to be praying for this initiative. We want to see people saved. Amen? We want to. Do we? I don't know if we do. Let's run that one back. We want to see people saved. Amen? Yeah. Like, I would love to see immense fruit coming out of this initiative. If we're going to 1,100 homes, one would hope that we're going to see some people added to the kingdom, right? So let's pray for that end. I believe that the Lord answers such prayers, and that as we pray now, He'll be preparing opportunities and hearts in the weeks to come. Additionally, to help in those conversations, last Sunday night, we had a Three Circles Evangelism training. I know many of you tuned in on Facebook Live for that. That's now available on demand whenever you like. You know, if you wake up at 2 a.m. and you need just something to, you know, entertain yourself, don't turn on Hulu. Go to HeightsvilleBaptistChurch.com and hop in on the Three Circles Evangelism training. That's what we all do in the middle of the night. And so, to help you with that, if you were a part of that last week, or if you would just like more tools to share your faith, tonight at prayer meeting we'll have bracelets that have the three circles on them, as well as a little track just to help you walk through this evangelism method to share your faith more easily. If those are tools that would help you, they'll be free to take tonight, as many as you need. I'm excited because we're about to have one of Garrett County's most famous rock stars come up and share with us here in a second, and I believe Dan is going to get him underway.
When you're a rock star, you gotta have a road crew. So you okay? Glass of water? Warm towel? Anything?
Oh, okay. No, I'm good. Thank you. Let's talk first service. We had a lot of stuff going on last year. pandemic's nearing a anniversary. If you know about that, the election and all that stuff going on, but I got a little song to remind you of something. There were some things I may not know. There were some places that I can't go. But I am sure of this one thing, my God is real, oh I can feel Him in my soul. Well, my God is real, He's real in my soul. My God is real, for He has washed and made me whole. His love for me is right to go. My God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Well, I cannot tell just how it felt when Jesus washed my sins away, but I'm sure, yes, since that hour, that ache and real, all I can feel is mighty power. Oh, my God is real, He's real in my soul. My God is real, for He has washed and made me whole. His love for me is like your gold. My God is real, oh I can feel Him in my soul. His love for me is like pure gold. My God is real, so I can feel Him in my soul.
Y'all just want me to preach like this?
That'd be great.
I'd have to stand on my tiptoes for that one, though. Thank you. I was reading an article earlier this week, and in it, it said that approximately 1 out of 5 Americans are what they call a hardcore hobbyist. And I was like, what on earth is a hardcore hobbyist? Here's what a hardcore hobbyist is. It's someone who spends 4 to 6 hours average a day investing in one particular hobby that they are just really interested in. Now, there's a part of me that really admires that kind of approach, right? Like, man, I would be a lot better at something if I spent 4 to 6 hours doing something. But on the other side, I'm kind of like, that's also a little bit kooky. Just going to be real. And I heard a story about one lady in particular. Her name is Trisha. She started playing piano at the age of 3, which in and of itself, I'm impressed. Like, piano at 3, I'm doing good to hit a key. Like, I don't know how she did it. But as she progressed through her life, she got more and more and more into her music. Until she's one day on the hospital bed, just had a complicated birth, and she picks up a recorder. Now, I have a recorder at the house. I should have brought it, Britt, as oversight. And I could play Hot Cross Buns on that in 5th grade. But then I got done with that, and I put the recorder in my closet, and it's still there. This lady, on the other hand, got really into the recorder. And she ended up spending 4 to 6 hours a day playing the recorder and other Renaissance instruments. There's more than one Renaissance instrument, first of all. But she spent 4 to 6 hours a day and started playing in multiple Renaissance music groups because she was so into, I say it again, Renaissance era music. That's a world that exists out there, y'all. You may not be aware. There are Renaissance music people. Do you know who wasn't overly fond of her playing 4 to 6 hours a day and spending her time going and playing in groups and playing instruments? Her husband, that's who. And unfortunately, their marriage was in deep trouble 18 months in to her musical exploration. Well, today our main idea builds out from this, because as she lived her life for Renaissance music, we'll see today that Jesus lived for his Father, for our God, in all aspects of his life. That Jesus lived for his Father in all aspects of his life. And you're like, well, obviously he did. But we're going to talk about it because I think it goes deeper than that. Because here's the reality is that most of us don't do that. We can say duh all we want to that sentence, and yet we don't. Yet we find ourselves consumed with any number of things, worry. Oh, I don't know how this is going to work out. I don't know what's going to happen if this happens. I don't know. Or despair. Just constantly repeating the same sorrows. Find ourselves consumed with impatience because I want it now. Shame, just rehashing that past mistake, living in it. Or maybe we're consumed by bitterness and the desire to get back at them. Or, I mean, if we're just being honest, they're all versions of pride. and being consumed with ourselves and our own desires and our own worries and our own preoccupations rather than what's important to the Lord above. And so what does God's word say about that? What are we to do as believers in a world that is so prone to looking at our own selves rather than looking at our God? Well, thankfully, God's word speaks to it, I believe. And it's in Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 12. We're continuing our series here in the Gospel of Luke. We saw last week, Jesus had a little bit of beef with the Pharisees. They were not getting along real well. These religious leaders were not thrilled with him saying different things about what to do on the Sabbath day, on their holy day. And he just turned around and informed them, well, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath, so I do what I want. What up? And they didn't really like that either, but that gets us to where we are in verse 12. Luke chapter 6, verse 12 says, "During these days, he, Jesus, went out to the mountain to pray and spent all night in prayer to God." Now I'm going to stop right there. I spent some time in youth ministry and I've done a few lock-ins. And I'm usually ready to sleep when 6 a.m. hits and I'm sitting there waiting on parents to come get a kid. I'm ready to get home and get in my bed. And so Jesus has just had a lock-in with himself and the Father all night praying above. And so when daylight came, verse 13, he went and took a nap and slept the day away. Now, he summoned his disciples. He just like rolled right into it. Now, I feel like that's a thing we could miss, but that just seems wild to me. He spent all night praying and then just rolled right on into his day. Just like, oh yeah, carrying on. I guess you can do that when you're Jesus. I don't know. Summoned his disciples and he chose 12 of them whom he named apostles. And that's where we got to remember. Jesus had more than 12 disciples. We hear the 12 disciples. That's what we're thinking of anytime we hear the word disciple, right? But Jesus actually had over 100 disciples following him around at any given point. But he specifically chose 12 of them whom he named apostles, which is a Greek word for like a messenger. It's a special title that Jesus gave these 12 who he wanted to invest in specifically. And here's who he had: Simon, who he named Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. After coming down with them, he stood on a level place with a large crowd of his disciples and a great number of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon. And they came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, and those tormented by unclean spirits were made well. And the whole crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming out from him and healing them all. Let's pray and we'll dive in on this word this morning. Father God, you know my own tendency to focus on my own stuff instead of you. You know, Lord, how often I think I know what my focus should be on. How often I think I should be wandering around and looking at any number of worries and despairs and problems. But Lord, we know that all of those pale in comparison to you. Help us today live that out. Help us to see the example that your Son set for us, our Savior set before us, so that way we could walk in righteousness as well. And empower us through your Spirit to do it starting this very day. Pray especially this morning for anyone who may not yet know the Lord, may not know you as Savior. Lord, work in their hearts. Lead them to see their need for the power of Jesus Christ to change their lives and the hope that he brings amidst our problems. It's in your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. 5 points of application today from this little passage in Luke. 5 ways specifically that Jesus lived for his Father. Number 1, Jesus lived for his Father. Jesus lived for God in his personal life. You look in verse 12 again, it says, "During those days, he went out on the mountain to pray and spent all night in prayer to God." Now, if you think about it, Jesus could have spent that evening doing anything he liked. And honestly, like, we think about Jesus as God, and rightfully so. And so I think we get to passages like this, and it gets really easy for us to be like, well, obviously, Jesus spent all night in prayer. He's Jesus. That's what he does. But we got to remember that while Jesus was fully God, he was also fully man, and he had every bit of ability to do something with his night other than spend it all night in prayer. He could have built a campfire, had some s'mores, sang a few songs with the crew. Maybe he wanted to go out spelunking in a cave with a light. I don't know what Jesus... Y'all are a tough crowd this morning. Y'all not working with me. We gotta wake up. He could have done any number of things with his time, right? But instead, he specifically chose to spend that evening not in sleep, not pursuing other interests, but instead pursuing his God. And if Jesus, who is fully God, needs to spend time in prayer with the Father, how much more all of us who ain't God, how much more do we need to spend time with our Lord alone? And yet, so frequently, we do everything but that. Think about how we start our day. Almost all of us start our day at this point with the looking at our phones, scrolling, swiping, liking. We then turn our phone off and we go into the room where either we're talking to somebody or we're playing the radio or we're watching the news. We get ready for the day and then we head out the door, poof, into our cars where we're inevitably also listening to the radio or something of the sort just to get to our jobs or just to get to our errands for the day, surrounded by more people and more noise and more chaos. We go through the whole day of that mess. Then getting home to, you guessed it, the family who's now running around creating their own noise and chaos and has their own life stuff going on. We then turn on the news or something else, probably better off if it's not the news, but we turn on the TV and now we got more noise coming at us. And that happens until we fall asleep on the couch and then Brittany wakes us up at 3 a.m. and tells us to go to bed. And then we go in and go to bed, we go to sleep, and then we reset for the next day. We have this constant blur of noise and chaos around us in this life in 2021 from the moment we wake up until the moment we go to bed, and then we just start it all over again. There is never a time that quietness, solitude, stillness with our God is needed more than right now, when our lives are as loud and as hectic as they've ever been. More than ever, we need that personal time with our God. And yet we also know that statistically, very few of us are taking the time to do it. Every research study I've seen since I've been in ministry, which at this point is over 10 years now, every single one of them has shown that the number one factor for a person's faith growing in the Lord or not is whether or not they have a consistent time with God or not. Whether or not they're spending time in the Word and in prayer or not. If you are wondering why your faith isn't taking off or why you're not on fire for the Lord, I can almost guarantee I know why. You are likely not consistently in the Word. It's almost a 1-to-1 ratio. We need time with our God alone. And now I know some of y'all, you got kids, you got stuff going on. Life is crazy. I don't have time, preacher, to spend all night praying. I'm not Jesus. I can't roll out of that and just go to work. That's not what I'm asking. I wouldn't even do like some preachers who would say, well, you got to do it first thing in the morning. Have your morning quiet time before anything else. You've got to be in the Word with the Lord. Because I understand, like, while that's maybe helpful and it's what I aim to do personally, some of us are doing good to get out of the bed, inject coffee into our veins, and take out the door before the sun's up. For some of us, a morning quiet time isn't realistic. It isn't part of what we are made to do. So rather than me sit here and prescribe for you what this looks like, I'm going to put the onus on you. You need to look at your life and your rhythms and your personality and think about where is God making it for you to best spend time with Him. Maybe it's just 5 minutes in this season of your life where you are getting away with Him in quietness, in the Word, and in prayer. You might be like, well, what good's 5 minutes? Well, 5 minutes every day is a whole lot better than that 30 minutes you might do once a month. Because that's what'll happen, right? Like, we'll have that one day of like the perfect quiet time where everything is exactly like it's supposed to be. I read my Bible. I prayed through the prayer list. I read a devotional. I listened to a praise song. And heaven fell down that morning. Manna covered the ground. It was the greatest thing on earth. And then we don't do anything for like a month. Because we get busy the next day. We don't have time to do all of that. And so we skip it. And we say, I'll get to it tomorrow. And it just drags. Find what you can do sustainably. Maybe it's 5 minutes, maybe it's 10 minutes, maybe it is an hour. Maybe instead of letting The Crown continue on Netflix, or maybe instead of watching 3 news shows in the evening, maybe just watch 2 and spend that time in the Word. I don't know what the flow for your life is, but you have to have this time in the Word. Secondly, Jesus lived for His Father in community. We talk about community a lot here at HBC. It's one of our 3 core values. We believe truly that God has made us to be in relationships with other human beings, worshiping our God and investing in one another. We believe that all the way. It's why we're excited to be bringing back community groups next week, so we can get back into that rhythm of spending time with one another. And Jesus had His own community group. If you look here in verses 13 through 16, Jesus had a community group, a group of 12, who He was investing in and sharing life together with in a way that He couldn't with the masses. And have y'all ever taken a good look at who's in this? Because I feel like we know like 2 of these disciples, and then the rest of them, it's like, I don't know who that Yehu is. It says Simon, whom He also named Peter. We always give Simon a bunch of trouble because he's a doofus that says stupid stuff all the time. We give him grief, and yet he was probably fluent in 2 to 3 languages and was apparently a fairly successful businessman. But he was also a rough and tumble fisherman out on the lake all day, every day, with number 2, his brother, Andrew. They grew up in a little town called Bethsaida, right there on the edge of the Sea of Galilee, this big, huge lake, and they were commercial fishermen. Their partners in the business, 3 and 4 of the disciples, were James and John, which sounds like some dudes I either would want to be friends with or I would be scared of. I'm not really sure which, because their nickname was the Sons of Thunder. And I don't know exactly what your lifestyle's like that you're getting called the Sons of Thunder. That either sounds like a good time or legal trouble. And I don't think there's an in-between. You've got the Sons of Thunder, fishing companions. That's the first 4. They're all from the same hometown. The next 2 are also all from Bethsaida. Peter and Bartholomew, or Nathanael as the Gospel of John calls him, were childhood friends, probably even with Peter, Andrew, James, and John. They're always seen together in the Bible. And so if you think about it, out of the 12, 6 of them came from 1 small fishing village on the edge of the Sea of Galilee. That's an interesting start. And then Jesus builds from there. We see Matthew, verse 15, also known as Levi. He was what they called a tax collector. And now this is not the IRS showing up at your door. To be a Jewish tax collector in this time period You were working for the occupying Roman government, a foreign government who has put all of their power on your land, and you were a local working on their behalf, taking money from your own people to fund their occupation. That's problematic. Additionally, most tax collectors usually hiked up the tax a little extra so that way they could skim off some more for themselves and live large off the money of their fellow members of the Jewish race and nation. Now, I want you to think about the politics of said person. Matthew, we assume, is no longer a thief. However, he's probably still got some level of pro-Roman mindset. He's been a tax collector for years. Enter fellow member of the 12, Simon the Zealot, which the Zealots were basically a terrorist organization looking to remove the Roman government by force. That all that mattered was the Jews, get out of here, Rome. Now, I want you to think about those two sitting down in a Sunday school class together and having coffee. I can't imagine that went well. Out the gate, you got to think they got in a few heated conversations, and yet they're both in this group. You've got Thomas, whose primary thing he's known for is being a doubter. That's optimistic. We've got James, the son of Alphaeus, who nobody knows who he is. But we know his mom because she's the other Mary at the resurrection. Mary Magdalene, the other Mary, yeah, that's his mama. We know his mama more than him, and he's in the 12. It's a bummer. You got Judas, the son of James, who, understandably so, goes by Thaddeus. Other places in the Bible, I'd probably change my name if I were Judas and a disciple as well, because we all know the other Judas is probably not someone he wanted to get confused with. Judas Iscariot, of course, the traitor, the one who would betray Jesus, and who Jesus knew was going to betray him from this moment forward. That is a bunch of misfits. There's more misfits in the 12 than all of the island of misfit toys with Rudolph and his homies. Like, that's a bunch of weirdos. And yet they're all in community together. What is happening here? And this is where we got to remember, as the church, we're not meant to be a bunch of people who've got it all together, who are putting our best face on, and who have just got this whole life thing figured out while the rest of the world goes to hell around us. That ain't the church. We're a bunch of misfits, broken and healing before our God, coming to Him not as people who've got it all together, but coming to Him as people who need it put all together. That's what the church is meant to be. Not a holy huddle, but more like a hospital full of hurting people with messed up, crazy lives and all kinds of different opinions and thoughts about the world. But we're going to come up in here together and be one, because our Jesus is healing us all wherever we're at in that process. That is Christian community. And Jesus believed in it. Third, Jesus lived for his Father, not just in his personal life, not just in community, but also in his ministry. Verse 17 says, after coming down with them, this is all the same day, he stood on a level place with a large crowd of his disciples and a great number of people from all Judea and Jerusalem, so Jewish people, and from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon. They came to hear him and be healed of their diseases, and those tormented by unclean spirits were made well. The whole crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming out from him and healing them. What is Jesus doing? Jesus is spending his day doing good. That's what he's doing. And again, this is one of those moments where it's like, well, what else was Jesus going to do? He's Jesus. Obviously, he's out here preaching the word and healing people. But remember, we all as Christians have a ministry assigned to us. Just because your title is not pastor or deacon doesn't mean you're not a minister. The New Testament is abundantly clear that every single believer has a specified task, a ministry, a gifting, a calling on their life to live on ministry for our Jesus. Every one of us. And we see Jesus is both speaking to those who want to hear, and he's also healing those who are broken. There will be opportunities you, personally Christian, will have this week to speak the good news of Jesus that nobody else under the sound of my voice right now is going to have. There will be people that God brings your way that I won't see. Nobody might see them except for you. There's going to be people who need healing and restoration, who need help. And you're going to be the only Christian they talk to this week who can help them find that healing. There's going to be people who are tormented by evil, by addiction, by hurt, by their past mistakes. And only you, out of everyone in this room and watching us and listening right now, only you will be the one in place to minister to them where they need it. You have a ministry to do. Is your focus on the Father to do that ministry, or is it on other things? Because God is putting things in place for you this week. You will either choose to do it or not. Fourth, Jesus lived for his Father by loving all people. And we see this not just in the disciples themselves, although we already said they're a mess. But even the crowd that he's got here, he's got a great number of people from Judea and Jerusalem, which are Jewish people, but also from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, that's Gentiles. We're out here in this crowd, in this ministry, with people of different political spectrums, people of different ethnic and national spectrums, people of different wealth situations. We've even got a different religious situation going on here, because you've got in this crowd almost assuredly some Pharisees, right? Like some dudes who were so up on following the Lord and on righteousness that they got Leviticus tattooed on the inside of their arm. Like they are some Jesus-focused, or at least some God-focused peoples. However, also in this crowd, you'll notice, there are those who are tormented by unclean spirits. There are straight-up demon-possessed people in this crowd. So you got a crowd that is diverse in ethnicity, in nationality, in socioeconomic status, in their political spectrum, and yeah, even in their religious vibes, ranging from a Pharisee to a demon-possessed person. That's as diverse and mixed up a mess of the human condition as could possibly be. And Jesus loved them all. Amen? He loved them all. And y'all, we cannot live for the Father unless we love everyone as well. Our purpose statement here at Hydesville is that our purpose is to love God, love people, and make disciples. We talk about that. But y'all, we cannot claim to love people if we do not love people truly. So often what we in the church mean is I love people, is I love people who vote like me, and who look like me, and sound like me, and spend money like me, and view the economy like me, and approach the world like me, and sing the same songs on Sunday morning as me, and dress like me, and da-da-da-da-da. This is not the way of Jesus. To love like Jesus is to love people where they are. No matter their political beliefs, no matter their ethnic background, no matter their views on gender or immigration or the economy or whatever, y'all, we have to just love people where they are, and we cannot be a church that if anyone came in these doors, they would ever be anything but loved and welcome. And that goes the same for us out in the day-to-day as well. There ain't a person on this planet that we as the church should ever turn our nose up at. Because remember, we're a hospital. We a bunch of goons too. We got our own problems. We got our own brokenness. We got our own baggage that we're bringing into this equation. And just because we might be a little farther down the road following Jesus, that don't mean a thing, because all of us are real far from being Jesus himself. We all just need to hop on the wagon together, right? And lastly, number five, Jesus lived for his Father all the way to the end. He lived for God in his personal life, in Christian community, in his ministry out in the world. He loved all people, both in the church and outside of it. But y'all, he loved us so much that he lived for God all the way to the end. Verse 19 says that the whole crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming out from them and healing them all. But y'all, something happened a little bit later in the story that has taken that power and that healing to a whole nother level. Because we now know the power of the cross. We now know the power of the blood. We now know the power of the resurrection. We now know the power of his reign forever and ever. And we have felt that power, am I right? We've got the power of the Almighty God at our fingertips through the Spirit empowering us in this life. We know it all because Jesus stayed faithful to the end. And he is coming in the end. And we must depend on his power now. That Trisha I talked about at the beginning of this sermon, she ended up, she's got a whole bunch of fans these days. Apparently there's a big audience for Renaissance music. She's in five different musical groups doing that. All five of them. And yet in that process, she also lost her husband. Her family has fallen apart. And while she would say and did in the article I read that she's happier than she's ever been, you and I both know that the recorder ain't permanent. That music isn't permanent. That this life and all of the concerns and the worries and the stuff that we are all up on is temporary. The only thing that is eternal is our God and keeping our focus on him. And so I ask you today, as we enter our time of response, have you trusted Jesus today? Is he your Lord and Savior today? Because here's the thing. All of us have had our focus on the wrong stuff. All of us are broken. And all of us have gone against God's word. The Bible calls that sin. And if we've sinned, that means that we are due punishment from our righteous God. And that punishment is going to get paid one way or the other. As it stands right now, it's on you to pay that for eternity, unless you are in Christ Jesus. Because today you can believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins, that he rose again, that he's ruling and reigning to make a way for you to be back in relationship with God now and forever, and find that punishment transferred from you to Jesus and be walking in the power of new life today. Don't leave this room, don't sign off this computer without talking to someone today about following Jesus if you never have. Today is the day of salvation. Find the power of Christ. If you're maybe a visitor or someone new with us, we're glad you're here, but I got to ask you, if you're a follower of Jesus, have you followed him in obedience and baptism? Have you taken the first step of following Jesus by declaring before the world that you are dead to your old self and living a new life? Have you joined a church and become a part of Christian community, truly and officially a part of a family? We'd love to have you here. But do it one way or the other. And members, HPC peeps, y'all, receive freedom in Christ today. He has already given it to you. Quit living focused on worries and on pride and on shame and on impatience and on jealousy and bitterness and despair and lust. All of these are traps stealing your focus and leading you away from the Lord and into, honestly, unbelief, because every time we focus on those, we are acting like they are more worthy of our focus than our Almighty God. We are saved for more than that. And so as we respond and as Dan comes and sings after I pray, lift those things up to God. Let Him have them. Shed them off. Those chains have been broken. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow, and He set us free from every bit of self-focus. Let it go. Let's pray. Father God, I pray this morning, Lord, help us live the freedom that You have given us. Lord, we know that we've been set free from these things. We know that You have made the way for us to restore and pursue the way that You made us to live. But we're so prone to wander, so prone to fall back into our old ways. Help us today, Lord, trust in Your Spirit. Help us today, trust in Your Word, and trust in the freedom that we have in You. Help us to live it out and live our lives, personally, in the church, and out of it, for You. It's in Your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Let's stand together.
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard Thee calling, come follow me. And we see where Thy footprints falling, lead us to Thee. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go.
Well, thank y'all for joining us, either here in person or on Facebook. Good to have you worshiping with us this morning. Remember, the chance response doesn't end when Dan quits singing. We're called to live this out in our daily lives. And so if you would like to talk to someone about something we talked about today, I'll be available up front after the service, or be sure to hit one of those connection opportunities we'll get with you this week and talk to you about how you can take the next step in following Jesus. Remember, tonight at 6 o'clock, we'll be back here for prayer meeting. It will be on Facebook Live, but there's something special about being here in person if you can. We know these difficult times, though, we want to provide both means for that. And so all that being said, let's head out into our day and help us do that. David, would you pray for us, please?
Dear and Father, we're thankful for the opportunity that You have given us to come to Your house this morning to worship You. Dear and Father, You have blessed us so much. You died for us. You saved us. You forgive us of our sins. And I pray, dear and Father, that as You have saved us and we have committed our lives to You, that we have made a commitment to serve You. I pray that You'll make us aware of that commitment this week as we go about our daily activities away from Your house of worship. Make us aware of those people that You put in front of us, that we are to minister to, whatever their need might be, whether it be salvation or whether they just might be hurting, whatever need they might be. I just pray that You would use us to meet that need in their daily life. Forgive us in times that we fail Thee and we fall short of what You've asked us to be. And we pray in Thy name. Amen.
Light of the world, You step down into darkness.
Guys, it's pouring down rain. So just to remind you, if you want to, we're going to move the